wonder if I can ask you about the Slender Man phenomenon, which, I mean, I remember, you know, I've my children are grown up now, but when they were, I think, 2008, 2009, 2010, I'm thinking, 09 and 2010, if I'm recalling correctly, was when I was hearing about this Slender Man internet meme. Back then, my kids were hitting, just approaching their teen years. So they were like 10, 11, 12, I think. And I remember this was like the big thing among a lot of young people. Someone had created this character. But then, even before you wrote about it, I was hearing that there were people having Slender Man sightings. And I just thought, what the hell is this all about? And then you wrote a book about it. And I'm just curious, like, what makes it a book? And what do you suspect has become with the Slender Man phenomenon?
Yeah, sure. Well, it's a very strange story, Rich. And basically, it began in it began in 2009, and with a guy named Eric Knudsen. Now, there's a website called Something Awful, and they ran this sort of kind of like a contest slash competition to see who could come up with the creepiest supernatural figure for the internet era. You know, kind of like a modern day equivalent of Freddy Krueger, that kind of thing. Or Jason, you know, from the Friday the 13th movies, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And numerous people entered this contest and uploaded photographs and, like, you know, sort of Photoshop pictures and artwork. And not hoaxing, I should stress. It was genuinely a contest, you know, to invite anybody to come up with a really creepy picture. A lot of people took part. One of them was a guy named Eric Knudsen. And Eric Knudsen created the image and the name of the Slender Man. And for people who don't know, the Slender Man looks like the definitive Man in Black. He's got a black suit, white shirt, skinny black tie, and had this very pale skin and a completely faceless face. No eyes, no nose, no mouth, no ears. It's just vague shadows where they should be. And these weird octopus tentacles, like, flicking out of its side. So it does look kind of creepy, to say the least. Now, in literally within weeks, the whole phenomenon image of the Slender Man really took off big time, and you had blogs and websites and forums and chat rooms all set up in the name of the Slender Man, and there was an incredibly popular online show called Marble Hornets, which is like a found footage type show, like Blair Witch, but it was a series of 20-minute episodes which a bunch of guys put together, and they did a really good job of it, and you can watch all the episodes still on YouTube, and it's all, you know, like a fictional story of the Slender Man. Now, had it ended there, that really would have been the end of the story, but you're quite right when you said that after this, several months after the phenomenon began, and you had thousands and thousands of people you know, obsessing on the Slender Man and talking about it, etc., etc., people then started to claim that they'd seen the Slender Man in the real world, in their bedroom, looking up to the, you know, at the, they'd look out the window and see the Slender Man looking in the window at them, and like lurking in the woods, that kind of thing. And the more they dug into it, the more they claimed to have seen the Slender Man in their dreams as well, as if, like, the Men in Black, he'd invaded their dream states. Now, the big question, of course, well, how could that be? And this sort of gets to the crux of the book and the phenomenon, or the theory, if you like, of what are known as thought forms or tulpas in Buddhist teachings. The idea being that if enough people focus and concentrate on something, you know, we're talking, you know, about possibly tens or hundreds of thousands of people with the Slender Man, which really does have a gigantic following. The theory is that if enough people focus on the imagery, you can create like a real world version of something that rather ironically never lived. It's the idea that the human mind can project and externalize something and give it a degree of self-awareness. And so that's one of the overriding theories, that the deep obsession obsession on the part of hundreds of thousands of people obsessing on this image of the Slender Man has inadvertently, not rather than deliberately, has inadvertently created a real world version of the Slender Man, which has now sort of escaped the moorings of the human mind and is now its own independent entity, if you like, or entities, you know, where different people see the Slender Man according to their own perceptions of it. So, but this angle of thought forms, you know, it has a long history attached to it. To give you sort of a perfect example of how this can work, you know, if it is valid, one of the people I talk about in the book is a comic book writer named Alan Moore. And for people who don't know, Alan Moore created characters like V in the V for Vendetta movie. He also created the Constantine character, this sort of demon assassinator, who...
That was the story. Keanu Reeves movie, I believe.
Yeah, it was turned into a movie starring Keanu Reeves, but it began as Alan Moore's comic book of the same name.
Okay.
Now, Alan Moore has gone on record as saying that at the time when he was putting the Constantine character together, he spent a lot of time, you know, focused on how he would look. You know, his hair, his skin, his height, his clothing, his mannerisms, etc., etc. And he spent a huge amount of time on this because he wanted to get the image right because it was going to be, you know, a comic book, obviously. And he said one particular day, at the height of all this, he was sitting in a restaurant on the River Thames in London, England, and he said he saw coming towards him, striding towards him with this sort of conspiratorial grin on his face, an identical character to the one that he had created for Constantine. And he said he just did not know what to do. He just sat there staring at this figure who just, as I said, this conspiratorial grin on him and walked past. And Alan Moore said it was, for all intents and purposes, the exact character that he'd created, but which was not, you know, in the public domain yet. So again, you know, they have this angle. Is it possible that, you know, the human mind focuses on something so deeply that you externalize it, and the more people who believe in it and spread it further and further, or, you know, almost like a meme-like state, it then suddenly leaps from the human mind into the real world and becomes independent and self-aware. So that's in essence what a thought form or a tulpa actually is. So that's one of the primary things I talk about in the book as to how people might now be seeing this entity in the real world rather than just, you know, online or whatever.
Well, I would just say that whole discussion takes me down a road I would not have ever predicted that I would be going down.
Please try again.